Next, the battle over protecting the ocean and how that's playing out in California. NewsHour correspondent Spencer Michels has this report, a joint project with KQED's science show Quest.
Just before dusk this time of year, the fishing boats return to San Francisco from the Pacific. Their cargo of Dungeness crabs headed for stores and restaurants all along the Pacific coast. But fishermen are nervous that newly created ocean sanctuaries are about to eat into their catch.
You get to a point where you say, is this fishery viable any longer? Is it worth it for me to go out there and catch a handful of fish?
Fisherman Ed Tavasioff and others are worried about dozens of areas off the coast that California has either designated off-limits to fishing or has limited the take. Environmentalists say these marine protected areas, as they're called, are necessary because of overfishing and pollution.
Our biggest challenge is 90% of the big fish on the planet are already gone. You know, 75% of the fish species in most of the world's oceans are fished to their absolute limits.
It's human disturbance, it's pollution, it's development along our shores that we're encroaching on habitat.
Maria Brown is superintendent of the Farallones National Marine Sanctuary off San Francisco.
20, 30 years ago, we thought the ocean was limitless. Solution is the dilution to pollution, we heard. And what we've realized over time is that the ocean isn't limitless. It's the blood supply of the planet, and it's being affected over and over again by death by a million cuts.
In December, the State Fish and Game Commission narrowly voted to establish 36 protected areas along the state's southern coastline, more than 350 square miles. That's more than 15% of southern coastal waters where commercial and sport fishing is either restricted or forbidden. Plans for northern waters will be in place by 2012. When it all gets done, it'll be a watershed moment for the state, according to Ken Wiseman, executive director of the California Marine Life Protection Act Initiative, a partnership between the state and private groups.
There are big reserves, and there are specific ones in Florida or in New Zealand, but never before have we done an entire network where the whole state is connected along all 1,200 miles of the coastline. And I think it's going to really set a trend and have a healthier ocean.
California actually began trying to preserve the ocean nearly 100 years ago, but the areas chosen for protection were too small and didn't work very well. This time, the zones are bigger, and teams of scientists have advised the state on which areas to protect, which species are crucial, and how to monitor the zones to see if they are working. There are no markers or boundary lines on the surface of the ocean. Fishermen and others are expected to read notices and use GPS to stay out of protected areas. As for the fish, I asked Steve Weisberg, a biologist with the California Ocean Protection Council.
You think a fish is going to know that this is a protected area and over that line they could catch me?
There are MPAs that have been done in other parts of the world where scientists have actually gone and tagged the fish. And after a while, the fish do figure out where the boundaries are, and you actually see them maintaining themselves within the boundaries.
Mark Carr, a professor of marine ecology at the University of California at Santa Cruz, has advised the state on marine protected areas since the program got going several years ago.
They're really more like the national parks on land, where people only go there to enjoy the natural environment and to recognize that we are protecting intact ecosystems for future generations.
Carr also thinks the protected areas will be useful as a baseline to see how a healthy region compares to the rest of the ocean. One of Carr's main interests is underwater kelp forests, whose health he considers a major factor in supporting sea life. He and his crews dive into the ocean and count what's down there.
We want to make sure there's plenty of kelp that produces plenty of habitat to support all the other fish and the invertebrates in the system. And so we send these crews in that are trained to count the invertebrates, the algae, and the fishes using scuba to characterize the relative number of each of the different species.
While environmentalists are thrilled at the expansion of protected areas, many fishermen remain unhappy. In the 2 years of countless meetings up and down the coast, fishermen, surfers, businessmen, conservationists have sparred.
Fishermen aren't trying to hide anything. We just want to make a living, that's all. Just feed our families and put food on the table. No one's getting rich anymore. Sardine days are over with.
We're doing everything we possibly can to keep the big fish on the reef.
Among those who testified against the protected areas is Larry Collins, president of the Crab Boat Owners Association.
Well, there's places that I've put my crab traps in for the last 20 years that I'm not going to be able to set my crab traps there anymore. There's places that I sometimes go salmon trolling. You know, sometimes they're there this week or that week. I won't be able to go in there anymore. It just lessens your options.
Besides creating problems for fishermen like him, Collins thinks the marine protected areas won't do much good.
There's no need for them. There's no need for them at all. It doesn't make any sense to protect one little part of the ocean. You got to protect the whole thing.
But protecting crucial zones does, in effect, protect the whole thing, argues biologist Mark Carr.
Marine protected areas are thought to be such a crucial tool for what is called ecosystem-based management, because a protected area will protect all the species that interact with one another within an ecosystem rather than just one little piece at a time, species by species.
Even so, Ken Weissman says he takes seriously the concerns of fishermen like Larry Collins.
I say to Larry and his colleagues who we invited to come on down and say, let's figure out how we can minimize that damage to your industry. At the same time, let's talk about how we can do the long-term investment that makes sure you have fish for you and your grandkids. But I think we've worked pretty hard to make sure that nobody was put out of business.
But that's not going to help him for the next 2 or 3, 4 years.
This is only 16% of the coastal area, so he's got 84% where he can still fish. And along that 16%, it's going to be a lot healthier and he'll be fishing a lot longer.
Despite the huge effort to set up these protected areas, there's one obvious potential flaw. The state doesn't have enough money to enforce the rules. There aren't enough game wardens, and so they're going to have to rely on a network of agencies plus the public, including fishermen, to keep an eye out for violations.
The people that are being regulated, particularly the fishermen, both the commercial and the recreational fishers, really have to buy into this idea and have to help police and enforce the protected areas as well.
Despite disagreements and some legal action, the zones are becoming law. Scientists say it will take at least 5 years of close monitoring before they know how effective marine protected areas are in restoring health to the ocean.